Hi, everyone. This is Leslie Law, your host for Sandbox Radio. What you're about to hear is our spring-themed episode from April 25th, The Words and the Bees. We had Seattle's rock star librarian Nancy Pearl as a guest, the amazing, lovely soprano Megan Chenovick singing some gorgeous, gorgeous Russian art songs, among many, many other things for you to enjoy. So I'm going to stop talking right now and let's just get on with it, shall we? Sit back and relax. Here comes The Words and the Bees.
Sandbox Radio. We'll stay all day in the backyard. We'll play. Jump into our sandbox.
We build castles and kings. Words become things.
Sandbox Radio. Sandbox Radio. Sandbox Radio.
In the show tonight. Sandbox Radio presents original work by Scot, Augustson, David Grimm, Lisa Halpern, Elizabeth Heffron, and Wayne Rawley. Along with musings from Peggy Platt. Soprano Megan Chenovick. And Seattle's rock star librarian Nancy Pearl. Featuring all your favorite Sandbox Radio players and the Sandbox Radio Orchestra led by Jose Juicy Gonzalez. So, sit back and relax as we take you into the world of Sandbox Radio Live.
Bobba da bobba danga dang danga da booba da booba dinga ding ding get it dip 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 do.
No, I love you like I do.
Dip 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 do.
No, why I do. Don't know why I love you.
This place is busy.
Yeah, it's super popular. Best food in town, and the service is outstanding.
Okay, I need one switcher special, left, right, and back to the left with a nod up in between.
Order up!
Maybe we should come back later.
Oh, no, dude, trust me, it's always like this. I can't believe you've never been here. How old are you?
15 minutes, I think.
15 minutes?
Is it cold in here? I feel cold. Are you frightened? I'm feeling frightened.
Of course you are, dude. Don't worry. Look at me. I'm 9 months old. I've been coming here 5-6 times a day since I was your age. Developmentally, I'm right on track. 50th percentile, straight down the line. And I swear to you, it's because I eat here.
Hi, welcome to Mom's Diner. You guys need a booth or do you want a table by the window?
Oh, it's too cold.
He's new. Can we just grab a seat at the counter?
Take whatever's open. Okay, who's next?
Don't we need menus?
Ask your server. Smart money's on the specials.
Hi there.
Oh. Hello.
Welcome to Mom's. How can I help you today?
Suddenly, everything is cold and loud and horrible.
I've got just the thing. What's your name, hon?
Well, you know, I don't know.
Your name is Felix. Here you go, Felix.
Felix?
Wow, this is a great place.
See, dude? I told you. Waitress, waitress.
Welcome to Mom's. What can I get you?
Hi, nice to see you. My name's Jasper.
I know what your name is.
Super. What's good today, waitress?
Boobs.
Excellent, excellent. Anything in particular you'd recommend?
The right one is fuller.
Great, I'll take it.
Deraining a right!
And it happens every single night.
Unbelievable.
Without fail.
You would think he would learn.
I'm lying there. I don't have control of my legs. I realize that. I'm not saying I have control of my legs. I don't. I know I don't. But still.
It's natural.
It's nature. It's science. The diaper comes off, my penis hits the open air, and I pee.
All over him.
All over him, all over me, all over everything. Some nights, it hits the crib like 3 feet away.
Impressive.
But still, it gets everything soaking wet. I mean, I require a whole new diaper, a complete change of clothes. It adds like 20 minutes to the whole operation.
Daddies.
All he can do, night after night, is stand there like an idiot as he's getting peed on, telling some person named God to damn it.
God?
Yeah. Sometimes he tells his God person to damn it or damn it all to hell. Sometimes it's someone named Sweet Jesus. I don't know. I don't think he's talking to me. I don't know who he's talking to.
Oh, I've heard of that. He's praying.
Really? Well, you think if he has the clarity of mind to call upon his higher power, he'd be able to put his freaking hand up over his open mouth.
Right.
I mean, just his hand, that's all it would take. It's just a stream of urine. It's not a laser.
Daddies are not always the sharpest tools in the shed.
Tell me about it.
This is why they so often get the night shift around here, so their mistakes can be hidden under the cloak of darkness. You have to be patient with them.
Hey, pumpkin.
Hi, Daddy.
My name is Daddy, and I'll be your server this evening. Can I interest you tonight in something off our after-hours bottle menu?
Sure, that sounds great.
This is a very nice 3-ounce serving, pumped less than 36 hours ago from your mother's right breast, and stored in the back of the refrigerator until just moments ago. The nipple is a Dr. Brown slow flow, just like you like it. And I think you will find the temperature slightly warmer than room, as the internet suggests.
That's lovely, thank you.
Can I get you anything else right now? Wipe any poop off your butt or anything?
No, I think I'm good, thanks. Just pace back and forth in tiny concentric circles until I fall back asleep, please.
You are perfect in every way imaginable.
Thanks, Daddy!
Wow!
I know.
He's good.
He's got experience. Do you have any brothers?
No, just a big sister.
See, that's why!
What's why?
Why your daddy gets peed on. Girls are different. They don't have penises.
Get out of town.
That's the main difference.
That's...
What?
That's just an urban legend.
No. It's true. I swear, it's true.
Did you Snopes it?
I don't have to Snopes it.
I'm gonna Snopes it.
How are you gonna Snopes it? You can't even hold your own head up.
Hey, kid.
Hi, Dad.
Are you hungry?
That's why I'm sitting in the booth, old man.
Okay, let's do this thing.
Yeah, except...
What's the matter?
That is a bottle of ketchup.
Huh? Oh, God damn it!
Yeah, you need to keep an eye on him.
Hello, waitress. Can I get some service, please? Waitress. Wait, hello, waitress.
Can I help you?
Hi. Yes. Sorry, I've been waiting.
Sorry.
Okay, well, I've been waiting, and I didn't know where you'd gone, and...
I had to change my shirt.
Well, yes, but I think that if you have customers at your table, you should make sure that they're taken care of.
I was only gone for a minute.
Well, yes, but if it's all right with you, I would like to order something to eat.
You just ate.
Yes.
You just returned your last order in full.
I'm sorry. Do you not speak English? Or I would like to order.
I'm going
to
go get the night manager.
Excuse me?
One moment, please.
Oh, my God, this is ridiculous. I have never been treated so rudely in my entire life.
Is there a problem?
I will say there is. Are you the authority here?
Yeah, that's me. I'm the big boss. How can I be of service to you, ma'am?
Thank you. I would like to eat. I would like to eat right now until I am finished eating.
It's 4:30 in the morning.
And?
You've been here all night.
Night? What do you mean night?
Night is when we sleep.
Look, mister, I don't know what you're talking about, but I have been coming here for years.
Weeks.
Excuse me?
Weeks. You've been coming here for weeks.
Weeks, years, whatever. My point is that you are very close to losing my business forever.
Have I shown you this?
What?
This.
Oh, please. This is unbelievable. Who do you think you are? What is your name, sir? I would like to know your name and the name of that hussy who was in here earlier. What is that?
That is your mobile.
That is just... Okay, well, that's kind of fantastic.
I'm glad you like it.
What holds it in the air like that?
That's what you have to figure out.
Oh, I will, sir. Is he watching that whale make another rotation? I'm going to want to continue our discussion. Don't you think I will?
Sure.
Good night to you, sir.
Okay, that was delicious.
Did I tell you or did I tell you?
And seriously, I can poop?
Yep. Right in your pants. They love it.
This place must do a crazy brunch business.
Oh, on Sunday mornings, it's a madhouse.
Plus, the waitress was very pretty. Will I always get her?
Yep.
Where do we pay?
That is the best part, my friend. It's free.
Come on, what's the catch?
There is no catch. That's what's so crazy. You come here and it's all you can eat 24 hours of the day for at least a year. All she asks in return is your complete love and devotion until the end of time. And you can never leave her side, not even for an instant. Plus, this isn't a rule, but you'll prefer it if you never loved another.
Sounds reasonable.
I know, right?
Yeah.
Who's next?
Know why I love you like I do.
That was by Mr. Wayne Rawley in the house. In the house tonight, Wayne Rawley.
Traveling bee salesman, every day in this big bristling burrow is boffo and bodacious. Oh my.
Yeah, who is it?
It's Nancy.
Who the hell is Nancy?
What do you want?
Hello, I'm Nancy. I'm your friendly neighborhood bee salesman. Can I interest you in a fine selection of the world's most bountiful bees?
What's she selling, Tyler?
Bees!
What?
We've got a wide variety to choose from.
No, look, lady.
In fact, we're running a special on mason bees. You wouldn't believe what fabulous pollinators they are.
Tyler, come back to bed.
She's got pollinators, Yolanda.
I noticed your old fruit trees in the front yard.
I got your pollinators in here, baby.
Dang, not for the bee salesman.
Why don't you just take a peek inside my case?
Oh, man, you got them all, don't you, lady?
Bumblebees, carpenter bees, sweat bees.
What do you recommend for pear trees?
Oh, pear tree blossoms. Those can be challenging due to their low sugar content.
I'm pollinating myself right now, Tyler.
Look, I gotta go.
How about if I leave you with the entire case? And if you're not entirely satisfied.
All right, thanks, lady.
Call me Nancy, just your friendly neighborhood bee salesman. Be well.
Tyler!
Bye, Nancy.
Oh, my.
And now, another installment of Plattitudes from the mind of Peggy Platt.
I'm a Northwest liberal. So I voted for no plastic bags within the Seattle city limits. Although as a Seattleite, I will drive outside the city limits to get the free good plastic bags. And it was in the parking lot of an unnamed free good plastic bag mega grocery store that I had an epiphany. I was exiting the store.
Save the bees. Would you like to make a donation to save the bees?
I thought I could use a karma point or two for the plastic bags and, well, it is the bees, for pity's sake.
Give what you can, because without the bees, where would we be?
Anyway, I was walking away feeling smug about my bee donation and almost absolved for my damage to the ozone layer when I overheard...
You're taking donations for bees? I only give to select charities, not special interest groups.
I guess bees are special interest groups now. Well, they are pretty special, that's for sure. They directly pollinate 30% of the world's crops, 90% of our wild plant life. Bees affect our whole ecosystem. They're just a little scary, like women. Special and scary. Sure, everybody likes boobs. They've been celebrated by Da Vinci, Rubens, R. Crumb. And women's butts, more popular than ever. Most lady parts are revered and loved. So loved that a third of the population keep their women covered up, protected, like a sandwich in a Ziploc bag. Sealed for freshness, to be used at a later date by their owners. Yes, the outside of a woman is very loved. It's the inside parts that some people find oogie. The original don't ask, don't tell.
Don't want to know what's going on down there or how it works. It'll just ruin it for me. As close as I want to come to the inner sanctum is rapping at the gate.
And who can blame them? It does kind of take the shine off. Buying maxi pads for your ladies' aunt Flo. Periods are a chick thing. Nothing a man should deal with, so suck it up. 4 to 7 days a month. 5 to 10 days of premenstrual mood swings. 3 to 5 days of postmenstrual anemic exhaustion, and finally ovulation, the magic window of fertility. That time varies from 5 minutes if you're completely prepared financially and really, really, really want a baby 2-3.5 weeks if you're poor, 14, and haven't even had an orgasm yet. But I digress. Women's health is best decided by insurance companies, the courts, and the Senate. We as women should be willing to drive hundreds of miles for services needed. It's nothing. Just birth, reproduction, a cakewalk. We just create life. And without women, there'd be no propagation of the species. Guess women are just another special interest group, like the bees.
Peggy Platt. And now, something from Dylan Thomas.
The force that through the green fuse drives the flower, drives my green age, that blasts the roots of trees, is my destroyer. And I am dumb to tell the crooked rose, my youth is bent by the same wintry fever. That drives the water through the rocks, drives my red blood, that dries the mouthing streams, turns mine to wax. And I am dumb to mouth unto my veins, how at the mountain spring, the same mouth sucks. The hand that whirls the water in the pool stirs the quicksand. That ropes the blowing wind, hauls my shroud sail. And I am dumb to tell the hanging man how of my clay is made the hangman's line. The lips of time leech to the fountainhead. Love drips and gathers, but the fallen blood shall calm her sores. And I am dumb to tell a weather's wind how time has ticked a heaven round the stars. And I am dumb to tell a lover's tomb how at my sheet goes the same crooked worm.
Richard Ziman and Dan Tierney on the drums.
Sandbox Radio.
Once upon a time, there was a young boy who heard the cry of plants and trees everywhere.
Help!
Hello, flower. What's wrong?
Hey, little dude. I'm so depressed.
Oh, boy. You guys look like you need some fertilizer. Here you go.
Oh, hey. That's nice.
As he matured, his appetite for plant knowledge grew and grew, and he just couldn't help himself. He was compelled to do good plant deeds, whether people knew they needed his help or not.
Don't be stupid. You can't put that plant there. It goes over here.
Stupid? That's it. I'm never speaking to you again.
Fine.
This is the end. This is the end, I tell you, the end.
Oh, well, finally we got to the end.
Hey, don't fight. Let me help. That little guy should go over here.
Over there?
No. You wanted to plant it in a full sunspot, right?
Yeah, plants need sun to grow.
And you wanted to plant it in a shady spot.
Exactly. Too much sun will fry the leaves.
There's a great book you should check out. It's called Right Plant, Right Place.
Huh.
Your bleeding heart requires partial light. Too much or not enough sun and it'll croak.
Who knew? Thank you, sweetie.
What's your name, little dude?
Jose.
You're like a mini superhero. We should call you something. Plant boy?
No, no, something more unique, like Guerrilla Gardener.
Ooh. Yeah, that's cool.
I love that. And I love you. Sorry I called you stupid, honey. That was just me being stupid.
I know. Just don't ever do it again and we're good.
And ever since that day, the world knows him as Guerrilla Gardener.
Gorilla chicken boots. Gorilla gardener. Chicken chicken boots. Gorilla chicken boots. Gorilla gardener. Chicken chicken boots. Gorilla chicken boots. Gorilla gardener. Chicken chicken boots. Gorilla chicken boots. Gorilla gardener. Chicken chicken boom.
But even a superhero has time for his own garden.
I wonder how my worms are doing.
What's cracking, Breezy?
Hey, worms, what's up?
Hey, not much.
How about you?
Man, what you doing?
I'm gonna go to the garden store and get some plants for my window box.
Hey, bring us back something.
I got you covered. I always take care of my worms.
Gorilla chicka puppets, gorilla gardener, chicka chicka puppets, gorilla chicka puppets, gorilla gardener, chicka 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 boom.
Hey, Steve, what's up, man?
I don't know. I just woke up this morning and my whole garden was weeded and mulched and pruned.
Do you think it was the Guerrilla Gardener?
Who else could it be? Ah!
All right. I gotta buy a few annuals and I need some herbs.
Help me.
Wait, whoa, 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 whoa. That sounds like an abutilon in trouble. Where are you?
Ooh, you look thirsty. Here.
Thanks, handsome.
No problem. Now, I still gotta find some plants for my window box.
So what am I, chopped liver?
Anything but. All right, you can come with me. Now, let's go find a few more to keep you company. Ouch! That hurts.
I can't do this!
Hey, easy, sister.
Who are you?
Gorilla chicka pizza, gorilla gada, chicka chicka boom!
So, what seems to be the problem?
Gardening! It's too scary!
I've heard it called a lot of things, but scary?
You don't know what I've been through. I'm a murderer!
Wait, now what?
It's true. I didn't mean to, but I did it. I killed another houseplant. Dead! Dead, I tell you! And I don't want to kill again. Can you help me?
Hells to the yeah!
I can't even pick out a houseplant for my living room.
Is there a lot of light, medium light, or no light at all?
Medium light.
How about the sense of area? It likes medium light. You can let it dry out in between waterings. It's real easy. Ever tried outdoor gardening?
I'm sorry, I did! I'm a murderer!
Oh, now that happens sometimes, but don't let that stop you. Ever thought of putting together a window box?
I don't know if I can commit to something that huge.
Queen of the world, it can be as easy as you need it to be.
Really? Easy's good.
Excellent. What rocks your world, flowers or herbs?
Flowers, definitely flowers.
Now we're talking. Okay, now, we'll just fill the box with dirt and compost like this.
Oh,
pop these plants in like so. And voila. Now, one thing to keep an eye out for, some window boxes are under overhangs, and they don't get much rain, so check them regularly for dryness.
Oh, I'm going to screw this up.
No, you got this. Just remember, they like regular watering, and feed them with a liquid fertilizer. You can also remove the faded leaves and the flowers. It helps them thrive.
I can do that.
Yes, you can. Now, this here is a classy, sassy window box.
Oh my God, this is awesome! You really saved my life.
I wouldn't go that far.
Oh, so it is true. I heard you were modest.
Gotta run.
Bye,
yeah, bye, everyone! Catch you on the flip side! Gorilla chicken. Gorilla gardener, chicka chicka. Whoa! That tree in front of this apartment building needs a good pruning. Looks like another job for... Yeah! Let's do it! Okay. Now, the first thing to keep in mind is to go slow. Why? Because once you cut, you can't put it back. Just remember the three D's of pruning. Dead wood, diseased wood, damaged wood. Remove those first. Now, when pruning, cut close to the branch. This helps it heal faster.
Hey man, what do you think you're doing?
Oh, your tree was in desperate need of some pruning.
Just a second, I'm coming out there.
Hey.
Hey, it looks pretty good, don't you think?
Look, man, I didn't call a pruner.
Relax. I just had to prune your tree.
No, I'm not paying you anything.
It's not about money.
Wait a minute. Gorilla gardener?
Chicka-boom. Yeah, that's right. That's right. How you doing? What's up?
Hey, how you doing? All right, I never met a real superhero before.
Go on.
Wow. Hey, thanks a lot. Man. That does look good.
Yeah, it looks a lot better.
Mm. Yo, hey, since you're here, would you mind taking a look at my cactus?
That'll cost you.
But...
Just kidding.
Okay, because I thought you were free.
Yeah.
So I had heard about the gorilla gardener, but I didn't actually believe you existed. I mean, we live in a society where it's become illegal to plug other people's parking meters, so it's kind of hard to believe there's this guy running around taking care of other people's gardens. It was pretty cool. Hey, Gorilla Gardener dude, is there anything at all I can do to repay you?
Well, I got my eye on that banana peel. Can I have it?
What for?
I got some friends who will dig it.
Okay.
Thanks, man.
I still can't believe you're real.
Yes, Virginia, there is a gorilla gardener.
Hey, wait a minute. How did you know my name?
Right on. Hey, worms.
Hey, what'd you bring?
Here you go.
Whoa, banana peel!
You gotta keep the worms happy to get the beautiful compost. Well, the worms are fed. We helped someone get over her fear of gardening. Saved a tree? Gorilla chicka chicka ba boom, gorilla gardener, boom, strikes again.
Stay tuned for the next episode of Gorilla Gardener.
Let's do it! Gorilla chicka, gorilla gardener, chicka chicka boom, gorilla chicka boom, gorilla gardener, chicka chicka boom.
That piece was written by the delightful Lisa Halpern.
Welcome to the Bitter Lake Business Depot, better living through bottom price business cards. How can I help you?
Hi again, it's Nancy, your friendly neighborhood bee salesman.
Oh yeah, Nancy, our bee salesman. Has it been bopping? Last time you came in, you sold us all those bee books, including the Burroughs, yeah?
Naked Lunch, Junkie and Queer, I believe.
Yeah, that's right. Oh, the staff really got off on it.
Well, I'm back, and boy, do I have some great bees for you.
Look, Nance, I hate to say it, but the boss wasn't that into the Burroughs.
She wasn't?
No, too many people started showing up to work with apples on their heads.
Oh, that's not that unusual.
She was wondering if you had any Baldwin or Bronte or Bloom.
Judy Bloom?
Yeah, big seller. Goes good with bubble wrap.
Well, let's just open up the case and see what screams out at us, shall we?
Oh, Heathcliff!
People are trapped in history, and history is trapped in them.
We must increase our bust!
Oh, yeah! Bronte, Baldwin, and Bloom. Hey, Belva, get over here. It's the bee salesman. Help me pick some bees that'll complement our business cards.
Does she have Butler or Bradbury in that case?
Both. Let's see. Here's a little Bradbury.
Fahrenheit 451? Most death!
No, wait. I know what we need. Dan Brown. That's the combo. Dan Brown, business cards, and chill.
Dan Brown? If I do, he must be way down at the bottom. Oh, here we go.
Mea culpa.
Yeah, okay. Order us some of that.
Brown, are you sure?
Totally what it feels like to spend your days amid paper products.
Word.
All right then, Brown it is. I'll be back soon. Be well.
Back at ya.
Radio.
Oh, hi.
What's up?
I've got a little problem.
What's the problem? Your live show is packing houses at venues around town. Your podcasts are tearing it up on iTunes and Stitcher and are featured on KUOW National Public Radio and KBFG Community Radio in Seattle. Things are going great.
Well, I've been seeing this audience.
Oh.
Yeah, when we first met 5 years ago, I don't know, I thought it was going to be a one-night stand.
Yeah, sure. But the chemistry between you and your audience couldn't be ignored.
Tell me about it. It's intense.
Well, the stranger called you crackling, electrifying, fresh, joyful, and awesome.
He was drunk when he said that, but it was nice.
So it sounds like if you're going to stay together, you've got to take it to the next level.
Yes. I mean, don't get me wrong. I really enjoy hanging out every few months on a Monday night. But, you know, I think...
You're in love, aren't you?
What? No. Well...
You are!
Okay, fine, so sue me. I can't help it. My audience, they're all I think about. That little snort they do when they laugh. It's adorable.
Okay. So you're in love.
But I need more.
Like what?
Well, I want to add more live shows, get me to a national audience, take myself on the road. I want to be on everyone's things to do when they're visiting Seattle list.
You want to start seeing other audiences?
Well, not other, just bigger. And I want to pay our volunteer artists something for their time and talent.
What about ticket sales?
I wish. Doesn't even come close to covering what I cost.
You are kind of high maintenance.
Who told you that? Did my audience tell you that?
Your audience loves you.
We love you, Sandbox Radio.
considered just asking for what you need?
My therapist does say that open, honest communication is the best thing for a relationship.
So?
So I've set up a crowdfunding campaign at Indiegogo. I'm hoping to raise $25,000 to take us to the next level. But...
So all your audience has to do is go to Indiegogo.com and they can contribute to the future of Sandbox Radio and keep your love alive?
Uh-huh.
I think you should ask them.
My heart is pounding. What should I say?
Just say...
Audience, oh my God, I love you so much. I want to spend the rest of my life with you. Please go to Indiegogo.com and take us to the next level. Any amount helps. And if you don't, I'm probably going to lock myself in a closet and die. Too needy?
A little.
Okay, here we're going to do a little audience participation moment. You ready for it? Yeah. We're going to divide you into the halves. This half will clap. This half will snap. It goes like this.
Bye.
Lucy Gonzalez and the Sandbox Radio Orchestra, with Lisa Halpern on backing vocals.
You're listening to Sandbox Radio. If you're new to Sandbox Radio, check out our website, www.sandboxradio.org, for information on how to find the podcast on other platforms and ticket information for attending any of our live shows coming up in our season 6. If you are in the Seattle area, we would love to see you at a live show. Now let's get back to the words and the bees with a verse play from New York playwright David Grimm.
Recherche du Frank Perdue by David Grimm. Enter prologue.
Prologue. Ahem. Prologue am I, by nature as in name. And mighty lucky am I, there the same. Had I been born an epilogue by type, yet christened prologue still, well, what a ripe old circumstance for comedy 'twould be. With as the butt of every joke, yes, me. But as I seek to bring you awe, not mirth, I'm mighty glad to walk upon this earth as prologue. This is my way. I don't like sunny days, prefer the gray. So in that shade, my tale shall find its hue. But first, let's gossip about Frank Perdue. So here, Frank's full tale I'll relate like this. Perdue lived by chicanery. A piss poor pun, I know. And yet it is the truth. Deception, fraud, and subterfuge, forsooth, were all the friends Frank had upon this earth, a sorry, solitary state. But dearth of friends and love brought riches to his purse. Why, he could steal a corpse from out its hearse without the widow's notice. It's a fact. I've seen him do it twice, to be exact. Though what he did with those cadavers, hell, does the term chicken nuggets ring a bell? Enough poultry humor. A musician it was, finally brought the partition of Frank from that which one might call his life. This player of the cello had a wife, much coveted and lusted for by Frank. He longed to nibble at her ears and spank those bouncy portions some call derriere. For 18 months, Perdue did scheme and stare, plotting a course wherein he'd win her charms and find warm succor in her naked arms. At last, his lustful labors bore him fruit, and Frank found... Frank found...
Please, don't let me interrupt.
Can I help you?
Go on. Don't mind me. I'll wait.
You'll wait? I'm right in the middle of something here.
You won't even know I'm here. Like a mouse. Continue. And Frank found...
I know where I was. And Frank found happiness in his
pursuit. See, you've thrown off the rhythm. I was... Yeah, but
go back a line or two. Build momentum. Get your stride.
I don't need advice on how to do this. And they're not lines. They're called couplets.
He could have fooled me.
Who are you talking to? Are you talking to the audience?
Sorry.
At last, his lustful labors bore him fruit, and Frank found who the hell are you, anyway?
Please, just finish the Perdue story. They're going to lose the thread.
No one's losing any thread, not while I'm prologue.
Sorry. Just seems to me, really, what is the point of a prologue? You come out here as a sort of a warm-up act before the real story gets underway?
Well, not that I feel the need to defend my position, but focusing the collective consciousness. It's very important to do that.
And then you're forgotten as soon as you're off the stage? Most directors dispense with you entirely. Face it, you're an antiquated and sycophantic device used only when there isn't all that much confidence in the main story.
Who the hell do you think you are?
I'm the epilogue.
Epilogue? There's an epilogue?
I'm sorry, I thought you knew.
Oh, you've got a lot of nerve to stand there and question my validity.
What I do is entirely different. I am the closure to catharsis. I am the final tears, whether of sadness or of joy, whereas you are little more than an usher who's been given some lines.
Oh, come on. All right. No, thanks, Evan, thank you. Look, what are you doing here anyway? Aren't you a bit early?
That's why I said don't mind me, I'll wait.
I bet I know what kind of epilogue you are, too. You're one of those apologias. You're one of those, if we spirits have offended, think but this and all is mended, purveyors of bullshit, seeking forgiveness for having wasted the last 3 hours of everybody's time.
Putting a story in perspective is not, ipso facto, an apology.
You, ipso facto, are a pompous ass.
Now, wait a minute.
Epilogue, huh? More like an afterthought. Ha-ha!
Lo! Now let the clouds of forgetfulness descend upon us like a dusky shroud. Blotting out the future for another tongue's retelling at another time! Hearken ye winds of comfort to the west. Come blow us gently homeward to our rest!
Come blow us? What the hell was that? Who says come blow us? And there was only one rhyme in the whole thing. You can't honestly give that as an epilogue.
Are you gonna finish your Perdue story or what?
Shut up. Where was I?
Frank found happiness.
Frank? No, I wanna go back. Build momentum. At last, his lustful labors bore him fruit. And Frank found. Damn you and your cloud of forgetfulness, you've thrown me off my game.
I've just had a horrible thought.
I know, what if I can't remember the rest?
No, it's, how do I put this? Do you notice anything missing?
Oh my God, my wallet. Someone's taken my wallet.
No, it isn't that.
Then what is it?
Think. What is the one thing which has always prevented you and I from meeting each other?
Actors' equity.
The play. You're always on before, and I'm always on after, and in the middle, there's this 3 hour span.
Oh. 2.5 on a good night.
So where are they? Where is everyone? What's happened to the play?
You're right. Usually by this point, a couple of nasty pieces of work in black tights come on fighting a duel over the honor of some girl in a corset. Right. That's when I know it's safe for me to go.
Hello? I have it. They're waiting for your final line. They can't come on until you've spoken your final line.
I don't like this.
Finish your prologue.
It's given me the creeps.
Are you listening? You've got to finish your prologue or we'll be stuck here for eternity.
Eternity?
Relax. Just focus yourself. Make your mind a blank.
You make your mind a blank. I'm trying to remember this speech.
Work your way backwards.
Thighs. Skies. Scorn. Born. Made. Played.
What are you doing?
Shut up! I got it! 'Twas at a concert which our cellist played that Congress betwixt wife and Frank was made. Each time he drew the G-string with his bow, did Frank her G-spot hammer down below.
You ought to be ashamed of yourself.
Hearing at last his wife's cries of pleasure causes our cellist to drop a measure. And in this momentary silence born are equal parts fury, outrage, hate, and scorn. With this rich brew, he curses to the skies Perdue, who nibbles at his wife's full thighs, dropping his cello, reaching for an axe. Our cuckolded musician swings, attacks, and drives the fateful blade into Frank's skull. Presenting to our ears this tale to mull, struck dead by forces nothing could assuage. Perdue was murdered in a cellist's rage. There, I'm done. Well, this is when the play is supposed to. Someone comes in from over there, and someone from over there, and I can't leave until they start. And you can't leave until they finish.
Hello?
Well, maybe they're stuck in traffic. Is 520 closed?
What are we gonna do?
Hey, audience, are you just gonna sit there?
But I don't wanna be trapped up here with him, honest.
Me? What's the matter with me? Why?
Help!
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 Oh, that lovely, lovely verse play was written by the fantastic David Grimm. This portion of Sandbox Radio is brought to you by West of Lenin.
I have traveled far away to come to this place. Crossed mountains, deserts, even frontiers of death itself. Where is it?
Man, you're not looking so good.
I am Vladimir Ilyich Lenin, leader of Russian Revolution.
Most excellent.
I am here in this Fremont because I have heard glorious Palace of Arts has been erected in my name. But I cannot find it.
Whoa, well, if you're talking about West Lenin, it's right there.
Odlichna! This is theater, da?
Yeah, da is right. They've always got something cool going on here. Theater 22, Theater Simple, New Century Theater Company, and, well, damn, a whole bunch of cool stuff that I can't remember because, you know, pot's legal. And West Lenin also's got art in the lobby.
Art that depicts the struggles of the working class, rising up and destroying the plutocrats?
Oh, no, just pictures and shit.
Ah, worthless bourgeois decadents. I will purge them.
You're intense. I like that.
I will bring army of Bolshevik to investigate arts and culture at namesake performance space. They will feel my burn.
Gnarly!
Later, dude.
Dos vidanya. West of Lenin, in the Fremont neighborhood of Seattle, the center of the universe. You can see performance and visual art shows there, or rent rehearsal space. They probably got a website. Just Google West of Lenin.
That's West of Lenin, or Waffle for short.
Whoa, whoa, wait, they got waffles?
WTF! Where's the app, people? The client's gonna be here any minute!
Still not done. Jason is coding like crazy, but every time we get into the code, it morphs!
It's morphing! What are you talking about?
Did you try brute force?
Banana.
Hello?
Who are you?
I'm Nancy, your friendly neighborhood bee salesman.
Guys, Brian's rubber ducking with Benson. Have you tried a boom sword?
The sucker's big Indian. It'll never work.
banana.
Looks like I've arrived just in time.
Whoa.
Is that sales case vibrating?
Behold, in this humble satchel, you will find the answer to all your problems.
We'd better, because we've got no friggin' app to show the client. Is that thing floating?
Inside is everything and nothing.
If you're suggesting a Yoda approach, we tried it.
Let her open the case, Brad. How can it hurt?
Gentlemen, I give you all you need to be here now.
What the? Oh, my knees are shaking.
We're going down.
Be here now.
Universe in my touchpad.
Guys, the client just got out of the Uber. Wait, what's going on? Get up off the floor.
Relax, Jack. The client can wait.
Wait.
The app will come when it comes.
But
just be. Absorb the vibrations, man.
Okay, I'll meet him downstairs, but I can only stall for so long.
He had an eyelash on his cheek.
Hey, thank you.
Nancy.
Nancy.
Nobody fancy, just your friendly neighborhood bee salesman. Now go out there and bloviate. Be well and prosper.
Nancy Pearl, everybody. Ladies and gentlemen, Megan Chenovick.
Oh.
You're listening to Sandbox Radio.
And me aren't on a first name basis. I could tell you I'm a squirrel. But don't go to the trouble of remembering any of that. Soon enough, it won't matter. I'll be dead in a few minutes. No point in giving a rodent carcass a moment's notice. Just a few short hours ago, I was paying a little routine visit to Maud the Mole.
Sade, is it you?
You know who it is, Maud.
I wasn't sure. I'm blind, you know.
Pretending to be blind was part of Maud's game. See, she was a medium. She'd read your tea leaves, she'd read your palm, she'd read the greenbacks right out of your wallet.
You want me to do your cards, Sade? Get a peek at tomorrow.
Like tomorrow's gonna be any better than today.
Maybe something real good is right around the corner. You never know.
How's your love life? Maybe I can help with that.
I'm here to deliver a message from Barbara Beaver.
Uh-oh.
It's about her wife. Barb says Betty is here twice a week, spending a fortune to have her fortune told.
Lesbian beavers. Who would have ever thought we'd see that in our neck of the woods?
You got a problem with dam building dikes?
No. Not in the least. But it's a free forest. If Betty wants to come calling, who am I to turn her away?
Who are you? You're a con mole, that's who you are. You're no more a psychic than the rye bread I had for breakfast.
I am an honest businesswoman. I'm just trying to share my gift of the sight.
And I am just the messenger. You want to mess with Barbara Beaver, be my guest.
Oh, Bob Beaver's a bit of a bruiser, isn't she?
And not above whacking a mole.
Some folks got no class.
Hey. Sade, while you're here, there's something I wanted to ask you about. I was gonna get you on the horn, but since you're here, you got a minute?
Yeah, I got a minute. But I swear to God, Maud, if this ends up being one of your cons, I'll use your skin on my bunions.
Jeez!
You try to help a body, and this is what you get. Here's the thing. I need your services to help me retrieve a certain object of considerable value.
And what object would this be?
Oh, you know, just the Woolworth pocket watch.
What? I had to knock those tiny teeth out of your tiny skull. The Woolworth pocket watch is just a story, a fairy tale.
No, it ain't. It's as real as the first snow of winter.
It was a long time ago. Summer it was. June, maybe July. Hell, it could have been August. A couple of humans came to the meadow and spread out a damn checkered blanket and put down damn wicker baskets and had one hell of a picnic. Potato salad, biscuits, beer, the works.
Oh, Harold, this is the best picnic ever.
Thanks, Gloria.
How about a kiss?
How about more than a kiss, big boy?
And then right there, in front of dozens of horrified woodland creatures, they made it as only primates can.
Oh, Harold, I'm getting wet.
Uh-huh.
No, I mean, it's starting to rain.
Oh.
Let's finish up in the back seat of the Rambler.
They left behind a pile of underwear that nobody wanted. And a shiny little trinket that everybody wanted. The Woolworth's pocket watch.
A lot of animal blood was spilled over the desire for that watch.
Mom, who is telling the story?
Well, excuse me for living.
After a lot of fuss over who owned it, they decided to hang it on the old birch by the pond.
But just seeing it dangling in the sun drove some folks crazy. It taunted them. Some believed it had the power to heal or bring love.
Love. They should have hung the panties in the tree.
You can be a very vulgar squirrel, Sade.
But it's been gone for a long time. They say human hikers took it away.
Uh-uh. It never left. Been here the whole time.
What? The Woolworth's watch is in the woods? Our woods?
That's what I'm saying. And I will make it very worth your while to help get it.
Okay. Why the hell not? Where is it?
It's in the hive.
Which hive?
Oh, you're not gonna like this, but the crazy bees.
Shit.
Yep.
There's this hive of bees in the crook of a larch by the brambles. On the north, there's a secret acre of marijuana plants. On the south, a patch of loco weed. These bees harvest the pollen from both. Those are some crazy frickin' stingers.
You up for it?
Well, I'm gonna try.
Oh, and Sade, listen. Be careful of...
Maud! For all the tea leaves and tarot cards, that was a fate the mole didn't see coming. So I set out for the hive. I get halfway there and my squirrel sense tells me I'm being tailed. I heard a rustle in the underbrush. I pull out my trusty .38. Okay, Joker, show yourself.
Hey there, Sade.
Slinky. Ah, jeez, kid, I almost shot your weasel head right off your weasel shoulders.
You wouldn't have done that.
Slinky was a funny little weasel with a crooked spine.
I was born with too many vertebrae. I don't move so good. I walk with a wiggle.
Didn't help that his mom and pop used to slap him around when he was a pup. He was always saying to me,
Sade, I want to be a detective too. Can I be your junior investigator?
Slinky, you're a good kid, but I ain't a babysitter.
We'd be a good team, you and me.
I had a soft spot for him, but he wasn't playing with a full deck.
What you doing today, Sade?
I'm on the job, Slinky. You push off and go home.
Can I help?
Don't you have a mulberry bush to run around?
You know, if you didn't want to be my partner, you could be my girlfriend.
I'll think about it, Slink. Now bug off. I drew closer to the hive of drug-crazed bees. You never knew what you were gonna get. What was their mood gonna be today? Silly, philosophical, or just plain mean? A swarm of buzz bees can be a dangerous thing. Something wasn't right. Too quiet. I stepped into the clearing and... Oh, Jesus, Billy Goat Christ, I'm a sugar cone! Beeswax and honeycomb and bits of hive all over the trees and the rocks. It was like the hive had been torn apart by an explosion. And laying on the ground, thousands of dead bees. I was so stunned, I didn't notice I wasn't alone.
Well, Sade, Sade, Sade.
Hey, pretty squirrel.
It was Patches, a wiry coyote with an unfortunate and persistent case of alopecia.
Yeah.
And his sidekick, Rux, a big, stupid, three-legged bear.
I like your bushy tail.
You boys have a paw in this mess?
Honey.
The two of us? Course not. We were just enjoying a morning constitutional.
Rux, what's with your face? You look a little swollen, like you've been stung.
And how do we know it wasn't you who committed this little act of insecticide?
Patches, really?
What were you doing here, bit out of your way?
I'm on a little scavenger hunt.
Are you now? Just out of curiosity, were you looking for this?
Oh, sweet marmots of the Lord. There it was. The Woolworth's pocket watch. Shining in the sun. I'd never seen it before, only heard about it. The stories didn't do it justice. It was the most beautiful thing. Now I understood why it could drive an animal to the brink of madness.
Sade, my squirrel friend.
Yeah, Patches?
Do me a favor and watch the watch.
You shot Maud.
Teach that mole to double-cross us.
The watch, Sade. Watch it swing. Shiny, pretty, back and forth. I have a very special task for you.
For me?
I need you to go to the old radio tower out by the highway. You know where it is?
Yeah.
You're gonna climb it, and right at the top there's a loose wire that shoots sparks when it rains.
Uh-huh.
You're gonna lick that wire.
Yeah, I am.
I'm gonna give you a word. When you hear that word, you'll be free again, but until you hear it, you do what I say. Radio tower, loose wire, your pink squirrel tongue.
The world spun around and melted. And I woke up here, marching toward the radio tower and my death. Crazy thing is, I know the word that will break the spell, but I can't say it. I have to hear it for it to work.
Hey, Sharday.
Hey, Slinky.
You look funny.
I've been hypnotized by Patches.
The bald coyote?
Yeah. Now I'm gonna climb to the top of this radio tower and electrocute myself.
I could stop you!
Better not try. I learned some martial arts from an old chipmunk. I'd snap your crooked neck. Just scram, pretend you saw nothing.
I could help you and be your partner!
Only thing that'll help me is the code word that I can't push past my lips.
That's a pickle, all right. But you know that old bookmobile that crashed into the ravine? I go there and spend some time and read. Maybe I know the word.
Slinky, what the hell? What do I have to lose? Tell me, what is it that's neither night nor day? What happens after the sun goes down, before the stars come up? What's that world that exists in that fleeting time between dawn and dusk? Junior partner.
So now we're gonna go get Patches and Rux?
No. You're gonna go back and tell everybody you found my charred corpse at the base of the tower.
Why?
Because I know where those two murderous thugs sleep, and I got a gun.
This is exciting!
Slinky?
Yeah, Sharday?
Lose the giggle.
Right.
I'd have no problems dealing with Patches and Rux. The woods would be a better place without those two, but the watch, that splendid watch, It was gonna be a lot harder. Glorious, but cursed. It had left a trail of heartache and bloodshed everywhere it went. It told the time, but the time was always midnight. I'm gonna take it to the highway and toss that terrible treasure between the white lines and watch as car after car grinds it into the asphalt till it's nothing but glittering dust. We don't need a watch. We're animals. We need to know the time we got the damn sun and the moon. And we know that when life runs down, you can't wind it up again.
The magnificent Scot Augustson wrote that in the house.
Never meant to cause you any sorrow. I never meant to cause you any pain. I only wanted one time to see you laughing.
Jackson,
Sean John Walsh,
Peggy Platt,
Andrew Litsky,
Lisa Vertel,
Catherine Van Meter,
Richard Ziman,
and I'm your host for Sandbox Radio, Leslie Law. And let's hear it for Nancy Pearl!
Sandbox Radio Orchestra, Dan Tierney on drums. Dave Pascal on the bass. Kevin Mosher blew in the horn. And on the keys, our maestro and composer, Jose Juicy Gonzalez. Tonight's show was written by David Grimm, Scot, Augustson, Lisa Halpern, Elizabeth Heffron, Peggy Platt, Dylan Thomas, and Wayne Rawley.
Our stage managers were Shigeko Collis Nakano, Lizzie Burton, and Teresa Micheletti. And the show was live mixed by Luke Kerwald and recorded by Christopher Stewart. So, we're bringing out some lyric cards, because now's the time in the show when we always love you guys to sing along. I think you picked up the tune. Ready? Here we go.
Sandbox Radio, The Words and the Bees, was recorded downstairs at Town Hall, Seattle on April 25th, 2016. It was live mixed by Luke Kerwald and recorded by Christopher Stewart. Please join us in supporting Sandbox Radio. You can make a tax-deductible donation at our website, sandboxradio.org. And if you are finding this podcast anywhere on the internet where you can leave a review or a rating, please do so and help other people find us. I'm Leslie Law, your host. We'll see you at the next show, June 6th, at ACT Theater in Seattle. That episode, titled The Bridal Issue, it is June after all, will feature the Sirens of Swing and those talented kids from cello ensemble Cello X. Thanks for listening.